So the story is about modeling Pitt-Hopkins with stem cells and brain organoids. This is a recent work in the lab. Pitt-Hopkins is a neurodevelopmental disorder caused by a mutation in a gene called TCF4. It's a transcription factor. And it causes like a profound type of autism. So these are situations where those kids most often do not talk, have seizures, epilepsy. Some of them cannot even move. So really profound, severe types of autism. The prevalence is about 1 in 10,000. However, we do think that there are several kids under the spectrum of autism that due to the lack of a genetic sequencing, they do not know that they are part of the Pitt-Hopkins syndrome just because the phenotypes are probably mild and masked on the heterogeneity of the autism spectrum. So nonetheless, I mean, this is a monogenetic case, and it's perfect for disease modeling with brain organoids. And I'm so glad that Alex has introduced the brain organoid technology. Just briefly, this is not a new technology. Some people think that this is quite new. No, in fact, it was developed by Yoshiki Sasai in 2008. So this is the first description in a cell stem cell paper that if you just neuralize the cells in suspension, they will self-organize and form what we call these brain organoids. At the time, they didn't even call them brain organoids. They have like a different names. But the organization of the tissue is remarkably similar to the human fetal brain. So many people, many labs, including ours, have optimized and derived different protocols to make these more robust, more reproducible, more reliable, and even fixing some of the pitfalls that these organoids have. For example, you hear from Alex to create like mono single rosette organoid, which is more biomimetic compared to multiple rosette organoids. So and we also developed like a very simple and robust protocol that most of people in my lab is using now. We start from pluripotent stem cells. We neuralize by kickstarting with the dual SMAD inhibitors. So that neuralizes the cells, and we put them in suspension. They will self-aggregate and form these spheres that we can stimulate the propagation of the progenitor cells with addition of growth factors such as EGF and FGF. Then we just remove the growth factors and we let the cells do what they do. So these are only transient exposure to these ectopic factors. And they, we start from single cells, they end up with about 5 million cells after a while. A question that I often get is what kind of cells you have in these organoids. And as you can see, it's a very dynamic process. So the diversity of cells will actually change over time. So it really depends on what stage are you looking at. And I'll give you like a snapshot at 4 months old organoids. You can see that the vast majority of cells are glutamatergic excitatory neurons. We have the pool of progenitor cells that continue to produce these neurons. They are also starting to produce glia cells, mostly astrocytes. And we start to see some of the markers for GABAergic neurons. These are not functionally inhibitory neurons yet. They will become inhibitory neurons a little bit down the road when they are like 6-7 months of age. But nonetheless, I mean, that's how dynamically they change the cell populations. And so we took this protocol and we reprogrammed cells from a group of Pitt-Hopkins kids, about 6 kids and 6 controls. We used the controls, the non-affected father of these kids, they're all males, and then we look at these organoids. And so to our surprise, I mean, the phenotypes are quite visible, so they definitely mimic the macrocephalic brains of these kids. The production of the progenitor cells is reduced, and the expression of TCF4 in this cortical organoid is also reduced by half, which is consistent with the haploinsufficiency. So one copy of the gene is mutated, while the other copy is not. So compared to their control parents, I mean, you can see half of the expression of the proteins. So that was interesting. We decided to see if that also happens with another type of organoid. So depending on the factors, you can manipulate the phase state of these organoids. So these are another type of organoids. We call them glia or GABAergic GABAergic organoids, because they're mostly composed by inhibitory neurons. And as you can see, I mean, we also recapitulate the proliferation deficit. So these organoids are tiny compared to the controls. Once we have a phenotype that is visible like that, we always ask, I mean, what is going on? Is the proliferation of the cells? Are the cells just dying? I mean, what's actually happening? So one easy way to do that is just to slice the organoids, do some Mooney stainings, and trying to see the major cell populations, how they behave. And because these organoids also have some preserved cytoarchitecture, we can actually see, for example, number of the rosettes, as Alex pointed out. So they normally, as the parental line here, have multiple rosettes, and you can just counting them. And you see like a dramatic reduction in the number of rosettes compared to the mutant cell lines. Also, I mean, the population of SOX2 positive cells, which is one of the proliferating cell types in the early stages of brain formation, it is reduced. Normally, you see a reduction between 4 and 10 months. In 10 weeks, which is suggesting that the cells are differentiating to postmitotic neurons. But the number that we start with in the mutant cells is much lower compared to control. So these are proliferating cells that are just not there anymore. Why they are not there? So that's an interesting question. So we turn into gene expression, just performing like global DNA RNA expression and looking for potential pathways. So long story short, I mean, there's several pathways that seems to be affected. One of them is really suggesting that the type of cortical neurons that these SOX2 proliferating cells can make in the mutants are different than the controls. So these are markers for the telencephaly cortical diversity that we have, and we see like dramatic differences between the mutant and the control. So we look into validating that with immunostainings, and this is like some markers of different cortical layers. For example, CTP2 and SAPB2. I mean, you heard from Alex that these are different cortical layers, and we quantified them. And again, I mean, we see quite dramatic differences between the controls and the mutants at different stages of development. So basically, these SOX2 positive cells are not making this type of cortical neurons. So in theory, I mean, the patient's brains are missing some of these layers in the cortex, and that might contribute to the phenotypes that we have in those kids, including the cognitive decline and everything else associated with their conditions in autism. Always when we get this type of phenotypes, we look for some kind of in vivo validation. And I must say here that the mouse model for TCF4 doesn't show dramatic phenotypes. It kind of does not reproduce the biology that we see in humans. And by the way, for autism and other neurodevelopmental disorders, this is quite common. I mean, most of the time, if you knock out one copy of the gene in a mouse model, you get like a mild phenotype, if any. So for TCF4, it's not different. So the mouse just do normally and might not have like any like dramatic behavior phenotype that is related to the patients. So what happened is one of the patients in our cohort actually passed away, and the family donated the brains to our lab, so we could do the immunostainings and look for some of these markers in the postmortem tissues, and we were able to validate that exactly this subtype of neurons are also decreased in postmortem brains, similar as we anticipated from the cortical organoids. So that gives like a kind of a reassurance or validation that the data that we have with the organoid is actually mimicking, even though we have a very reductionist model in culture here. All right, so I mean, showing phenotypes in a cellular model is very interesting. But we, I mean, I think especially in this environment here, we are very translational. We want to not only find phenotypes, we want to do something about it so we can translate that to the families. And so we thought about that. TCF4, as I mentioned, is mutated in one copy of the gene. The other one is highly functional. What if we can compensated the haploinsufficiency by overexpression of the version of the gene that is known mutant. You can do now something like that using CRISPRs. We can use a CRISPR activator that would bind to the promoter of the TCF4 and force the expression of the gene so we can compensate that. And that was very successful. So this transactivation approach was able to restore the level of TCF4 inside these organoids. Another strategy that, and these are just the probes that we use in the promoter region. I mean, this is something that it's kind of empirically defined. You have to design different probes for your CRISPR to bind in these promoter regions to see which one will work. So it's not something that we can really predict it. And I forgot to mention that TCF4 has different isoforms. And even those isoforms, there is no consistent agreement in the literature which ones are important. So we kind of design different probes for the CRISPR to attack or to express different isoforms here. And so once we have that, we put the CRISPR-I on the lentivirus, and then we infect the organoids at very early stages, and we look for potential correction. To our surprise, I mean, we were able to correct the expression of the TCF4. As I mentioned, it's a transcription factor, so it regulates the expression of downstream genes. We were able to regulate these downstream genes as well. For example, these GADD45 or CDKN2A, all of that we could correct. We also see the re-expression, for example, of the SOX2 positive cells that I told you that was down-regulated. But what I think was amazing is that, and I didn't highlight that, these organoids, the mutant organoids, have some malformations as well. There's some clusters of neurons that kind of forms some kind of scars inside these organoids. We don't fully understand. We see something similar in the postmortem tissues. And if you correct the gene early on, you can fix even the structural defect, which for me as a neuroscientist was something kind of surprised that during development you can fix the brain that was previously damaged. But yeah, that's what the science is telling us, that you can do that. All right, there's one major problem with the CRISPR activation here. It requires two lentivirus to infect the cells to activate the endogenous promoter so you can have the rescue. So that's not like an easy task, and it's not yet translational. So the technology still have to move forward. But one thing that we thought, well, I mean, yeah, I mean, if we show that we can overexpress TCF4 and have those rescues, why not just clone the cDNA inside an AAV, which is translational because we already have several clinical trials with AAV, and propose a straightforward gene therapy approach that would require a single vector to do the trick. So gene therapy, especially for neurodevelopmental disorders, where the dose of those genes are quite important, faces this problem of overexpression. So if you overexpress some of these neurodevelopmental genes, you might cause a very similar disease than the haploinsufficiency. So the tidal regulation of the gene is quite important here. And this is, for example, a problem. Take another syndrome, Rett syndrome. If you overexpress the MCP2 gene, you can create the MCP2 duplication syndrome, which is as bad as Rett syndrome. So we don't want to do that. And manipulating these AAV vectors to have the right dosage is a challenge. So our approach here was take advantage of some of the binding of the TCF4 in the DNA, and TCF4 binds to these micro E5 motifs here to regulate the expression of the upstream genes. We didn't know if that would work or not. So we cloned different sizes of these micro E5 boxes upstream to a minimal promoter that would fit inside an AAV vector. And Turns out that this expression, we can regulate really nicely the amount of TCF4. So we end up choosing like the right amount of micro E5 boxes to have the right amount of expressions that we see in a wild type or in a parental control. So we use that to construct our AAV vector approach. And then, I mean, we build the organoids, and at certain point, we infected with the AAV, and the AAV was very useful to transfect the cDNA back, and we see the re-expression of TCF4 to the levels that we were expecting. And similar to the transactivation, we see the restoration of the SOX2-positive cells, restoration of the morphology of the rosettes and the organoids, and more importantly, we start to see back again the CTP2-positive cells that were missing in the first place. These are more mature organoids. And these CTP2-positive cells, I mean, are important in the cortical connection. So it's part of the networks that really wire the brain at very early stages in development. And one way to measure the connectivity of those neurons is really to place the organoids on top of a multi-electrode array so it can record the activity of these cortical neurons over time. So this is what we have here. These are days of the organoids on top of the microelectrode array and different readouts that we can capture from the electrical activity of those neurons, such as a number of mean firing rates or number of network bursts. And I hope you can appreciate that compared to controls, in blue you have the mutant networks that are kind of reduce in a different time point, but upon the treatment with the AAV, you can rescue that. So that was a very interesting way to show that not only you can rescue the expression, you can rescue the cellular defect, but you can go to the physiology of the neurons or physiology of the networks. So that was a very interesting approach for TCF4. We are glad that as soon as we presented these data, Mazi Ultragenics licensed the program. They're taking this to a clinical trial, so they're testing now in primates. And we hope that in a year or so, this would be like we'll be recruiting for the clinical trial. So this is a like very short story here. Loss of TCF4 really impair. It's the Wnt signaling that controls this population of SOX2-positive cells. The decreased proliferation changes the composition of the cortical network, especially on these CTP2-positive neurons, that we also validate that in the postmortem tissues. And rescue TCF4 expression, both with CRISPR activation as well as straightforward gene therapy with an AAV. As long as you control the right expression of the TCF4, you can have like a full rescue with no side effect or predicted side effect. We don't see any toxicity from these vectors. So we're quite excited about that. The project was really led by Fabio Papis, who was a visiting scholar here in my lab. And together with several members of my lab, he really pushed this to happen. Fabio do have someone in the family that's affected by Pitt-Hopkins, so his motivation is way beyond the academic settings. He really wants to see this being in clinics. I'll stop here, and maybe we can resume with the panel. Thank you very much.